as you can see on the slide, there's a lot of logos. So my main work is at the university in the Ghent University Faculty of Bioscience Engineering, where I lead a research group named BioMath, which is working on model-based analysis and optimization of processes. So I'm a full professor there, leading a research group. But then on the top right, you see some other logos. And so in part of my daily activities, I'm also the COO of AM team, and also a chief advisor of another company called Cobalt Water. But I'll come back to that in the presentation itself. So let me just start off with, going back a little bit in my career, because you might think like, okay, why is a university professor actually going to discuss something on business opportunities in this respect? So this is a little bit an overview of my academic career, which is pretty traditional, starting with a master, a PhD, postdoc, and then became an assistant professor in 2008, associate professor, and then in 2018, I turned into a full professor. But let's say that along the ride of this academic career, there were already signs of what I would call intrapreneurship, which is actually similar to entrepreneurship, but inside an institution. And that actually already started quite some time back, because I always had an interest in and took initiative in both management and organization. So, for example, when I was performing my PhD, there were a couple of or I noticed that there were a couple of PhDs that were dealing with similar topics. So I decided to create a subgroup and regular meetings with these people to exchange ideas and to crossbreed and talk about these topics. That extended also in terms of organization. So actually, I organized my first conference as a PhD student back in 2004, which I think is probably not that that obvious. And then another thing was that my PhD supervisor actually nicknamed me Mr. Database, because I always wanted or was looking for organization also in terms of the practical stuff. So I coded part of the website of the research group. I wanted things to be efficient and provide ways of storing things efficiently and working efficiently. Okay, and then I also was the president of a center of environmental science and technology at our faculty. Something was sitting inside me, and later on you will see that this came out at some point. What I want to add here is that basically when taking the initiative in both managing and organizing entities, it's basically it gives a boost for your network. But also it attracts like-minded people, so that in your network you start talking to people that that have similar ideas, and people and networks are really important when it comes down to entrepreneurship and business. That actually further shaped up when in 2013, we were actually visiting the Ugand campus in Korea. You see a picture there of the finished campus, but we were actually visiting it when it was being built. And I remember the other guy that you see down there is Cornel Rabai, who's a fellow professor at another department at our faculty. And we started chatting, and we said, would it not be cool, as it's mentioned there, to also have a building where we can pool sources of researchers and equipment working in an interdisciplinary way on resource recovery in an innovative ecosystem setting, right? Bringing people together. And actually, that was the onset of the Capture Initiative platform that that Jan talked about earlier. Okay, then back in Belgium, we started talking to another colleague, Arne Verliefde. All of us have different backgrounds, but we had the same, interest in resource recovery. So Cornel more from technological point of view, Arne more from a physical chemical technology point of view, and myself from more from a model-based perspective. Okay, so I'm basically then these ideas further shaped up, and at some point, you can see here in early 2015, we started making some drawings and sketches and ideas of shaping this thing. And then this is the actual result. So this is December 2020. I think this picture was taken a couple of weeks ago. This building is now finished, and in a couple of months, we will actually move there and work there and use this specific ecosystem, which we also believe will strongly contribute to innovation, but also in valorization of new technologies or new things that will be developed in the context of resource recovery. So and I also want to say, you see, it took like 7 years from the idea to actually the conceival of this or the finalization of this this work. And now, of course, the story is not yet finished. Huh? We will still continue with that. But I think this is a very nice example of entrepreneurship, where you meet the right people and you have a common idea, and then you bring it to practice or alive. But then in the meantime, I was also working on other things. So another encounter I had that 10 years ago, there was a new assistant professor, Thomas de Beer, starting at the Faculty of Pharmaceutical Sciences. It's a completely different topic. But the thing is also there. So he knocked on my door. He said, "I checked your website and I'm looking for someone to work on or to collaborate on modeling of pharmaceutical processes." And back then I had plenty of time. So I said, "Yeah, why not? It sounds interesting." So there was a lot of synergy, complementarity, very nice and fruitful collaboration. But then I actually noticed exactly the same as what was the case in the Capture initiative, mainly that there's a lot of scattered research happening at different locations. So basically, we thought like, okay, why would we not make a copy paste of the Capture idea and apply it to this pharma research? Okay, and so at that time, this next initiative was born, called CESPE, which is a Center of Excellence for Sustainable Pharmaceutical Engineering and Manufacturing. So basically the platform is gaining ground. And actually last week we had our official launch with an industrial partnering day, which was quite successful. We had over 100 people joining this. And also, we are now in the phase of trying to also have a building that we can create a similar ecosystem and bring together the people from different angles working on this specific topic, which is another one. I think like resource recovery, I think COVID has clearly indicated that also our healthcare system and the way we produce medicines is also something that needs to be rethought. Okay, in the meantime of when all these things were going on, some other things happened. So in back in 2016, there were two of my former PhD students that that graduated. So Wim on the left and then Usman on the right. One was working on kinetic modeling of advanced oxidation processes for tertiary treatment of effluents, for example, or in drinking water production. Whereas Usman was working on CFD, so computational fluid dynamics, a specific framework for detailed modeling of processes, and extending that for wastewater treatment technology with kinetic models. Okay, so quite advanced at that time. Okay, and when they both graduated, you could sense that some chemistry. With the figure here, there was some chemistry between these guys. And also I had at some point already 2012 an idea of like, okay, there's definitely a market and an interest and an application of these tools, specifically then the CD tools for the market. So I basically started talking to these guys and said, okay, maybe we can join forces and create a spin-off. And then after, of course, some talking in January 2017, this company AM Team, which actually stands for Advanced Modeling Team, was born. And for people that are a bit older, let's say, they will probably recognize that this is basically related to the A team on the bottom right of the figure. So this was a series of a group of people or a team of people with, again, different synergetic competences that came together and solved all kinds of problems. But you have to watch the series, then you will understand better. Okay, so that was the idea behind. And actually, the quote that you see here is also one that we kind of adapted from the series. So they said, if you have a problem and no one can help you, you can find if you can find them, you can hire the A team. And so we kind of gave that a little twist. But that's when things happened. And you can probably also notice that fun is one of our core values of the company. Maybe in a nutshell, to mention to you what we actually do. So we provide here software services, and for example, on the top right, you can see actually a basin of activated sludge, so the wastewater treatment system. Obviously, in reality, it doesn't have this color; it has a brownish color. But what we do is we make a 3D simulation of that, and then we can lay it over. And actually, what you can see here are the colors represent oxygen concentrations. So here you have high oxygen concentrations, there you have low oxygen concentrations. So people always tend to think that everything is complete mix and concentrations are homogeneous all over the place. Well, I mean, I think that illusion should actually be out of this world, not even true in a 2-liter. But what we do is not only these oxygen concentrations, but also we can model, for example, all kinds of stuff, reactions we can put in there. We can have gas bubbles that allow us to model mass transfer between a gas and a liquid phase. You have mixing devices, you have liquids that where you can play with different properties. You can have particles and all kinds of things in there. That's the other gears that we refer to here. But traditionally, the CFD has been used as troubleshooting, right? And so basically, something's wrong with the system, and then we make a model and we try to figure out what is going on and what we can do about it. But then what I already had in mind was the two other things that you see here. One is model-based design. And the other one is virtual piloting. So model-based design, what I mean by that, instead of first building something and then troubleshooting it, would it not be smarter to use models to design your system so that basically you design the quality into it and that when you build it, you have a system that is optimally operating? To me, that makes much more sense. And actually, when I was presenting this case here to a group of students, actually, one of the students asked me that question, like, why don't you use the models to do the design? But I can tell you that it still requires quite some convincing to get this, in my opinion, no-brainer to people's minds. And then virtual piloting is another one that is maybe also a bit more controversial. But in engineering, what often happens is, you build a new technology, often at you demonstrate it at lab scale. But before you go to full scale, then people tend to build pilots of intermediate volumes. And yeah, also that, I mean, if you look at the way technologies scale, it's actually, I would not say a complete waste of energy and resources. But the thing is, you will bump into specific issues when you build a pilot. So it's more like, I compare it, it's more like having a security vest in the airplane under your seat to give you some feeling of security. Maybe some quotes then back at that time. So I took one from our CEO because he actually came up with it. And he told me like, once the animal is out of the cage, you cannot get it in anymore. And so what he meant by that is once your intrapreneurial or entrepreneurial beast is out of the cage, it's hard to get it in there. And he's actually very right. Also, when I started collaborating with them, that's also when I started reading a lot of literature on entrepreneurship. And for example, this one I can highly recommend, by Jay Samet. And basically, another one written here is, every problem is an opportunity in disguise. So basically, if you change your mind and start looking at or perceiving problems as opportunities or business opportunities, you see opportunities everywhere. Okay, so it's really a cool discovery if you find that. And problems are everywhere, as I said. And then I will come more closely to the resource recovery. But whenever you want then to turn a problem into an opportunity, you also need the right ingredients. So basically, solutions, meaning, you have to, for a problem, you have to come up with a solution or an idea of how you can solve it. But on the other hand, and that's probably even more important, you need the right people. And so the case I showed with the M team, it's just like meeting the right people at the right moment in time and also at the right time to launch a specific idea into the market. Okay, so that's quite important. And that's the same here finding these people is really the challenge, in my opinion. And then actually earlier this year, another good ingredient mix was established. The guy on the left, Jose Porro, is actually a PhD student of mine, but I've known Jose already for 12 years. So he was also a consultant in wastewater treatment and drinking water treatment modeling, and more specifically artificial intelligence and machine learning. And then the other guy, I never actually met him in person. Due to Corona, we have never been able to meet up, but we have regular meetings. He's a data analytics expert. Yeah, really cool. He has no background whatsoever in water. But it's a nice mix. Basically, what we then saw as an opportunity is that digitalization, as Jan already mentioned as well, is really ongoing and is really gaining ground in the water fields. And also, what I myself had in mind that there's actually a lack of service companies that, and that's important, combine both expertises. Yeah? So you can find the Googles and the IBMs coming to the water sector and say, oh, we have lots of data analytics skills, but typically they lack knowledge. Okay, so that's what I think here is the lethal combination of combining the right expertises. So it was the same with the other company. So you have to bring together complementary skills. Okay, in a nutshell, what we do in that company is actually focusing on at first the N2O, what we call N2O risk decision support system. So in a nutshell, wastewater treatments can emit nitrous oxide, which is a very powerful greenhouse gas, as you can see here, 300 times the power of carbon dioxide. And what we want to build is based on, let's say, traditional measurements like ammonia and oxygen. We want to actually build a system that can into a soft sensor, an N2O monitoring, and later on also a mitigation system. And we want to put this in the market as a SaaS product, which is a software as a service. Sorry, that's a typo here. And on top of that, so that's just one. On top of that, more in general, AI services for the water sector. Okay, and so this is just a pick down here from the product, how it is developed right now, and so basically we can predict online the risk of N2O. Okay, little other thing about oceans. I'm not sure whether anyone is familiar with the concept of the red ocean and the blue ocean. Basically, it has to do with competition. So if you have an idea, it's actually it's quite nice if you are in the blue ocean, which means that there's not many people or not many competitors there that go in this market. Whereas in the red ocean, typically you have fierce competition, and basically you would have to lower your price. That's really a game changer. So if you come up with an idea, it's actually much better to be in this location here, because you just simply have much bigger and larger margins. But the point I want to make is that if you're in the blue ocean and if you want to stay there, then you constantly have to innovate, and you constantly have to also be proactively looking at what is happening around you. And then, you probably remember this, and I will dive into the resource scarcity and how this can now be applied to that. So as Jan already mentioned in his talk, the next revolution, we believe, is the circular economy or circular industry. And Jan already said, the business is sigmoidal in nature. Sigmoidal, the S is actually standing there for the sigmoidal. I will not explain the curve, because Jan has already done that. So this is true for a business. So if a business starts, you will always start in the infancy phase. It will expand and mature, hopefully. A lot of businesses just stay in the infancy and never grow, because it never lifts off. So it's important to understand that. But the circular transition will also be sigmoidal, meaning that you can make a multitude of such curves for every transition. The other thing is that the transition, of course, will not happen overnight. It has many pieces of the puzzle that will be required, and many of them still need to be developed. Okay, and now I want to shed a bit of light on that, and I want to use this figure for this. And what I think is very important when you start thinking of this is that you try to imagine how a world could look like in let's say 10, 20 years from now, And in view of the circular economy, right? And recently we were writing a report which still needs to be published. But anyway, we made this this graphic, and it's a bit similar to what Jan already explained. So you have primary resources going into industrial processes, then going to the consumer, and then often you have waste products. So if and also here these there will be byproducts from this industrial process, which are typically also not reused. So what we want to do is we want to create these green arrows and make sure that that we close those cycles. Now I like to look at this from really a systemic point of view. Yeah? And one side note that I want to add here is that not everyone can think or does think in this way, and that's not a not saying that one person is better than the other. Some people are really good in seeing the details. Other people are better in seeing or having the helicopter view or the big picture view. Yeah, and I think it's important in a business that that you have at least someone on board that has this big picture thinking and imagine how things could look like. I'll come back to that in a minute. And I want to couple the opportunities for businesses in this resource scarce setting the fact that we go to a circular thinking into different parts. So first of all, the technology development. And that can, of course, happen in different sectors. I mean, in capture, we have water, we have carbon dioxide to products, and we have plastics. Those are only three, but we basically you can apply it to every resource. Right? So what we want to do is these side streams, we want to actually turn them back into secondary resources. Yeah? And for that, you can either use new technologies or you can also revamp existing technologies, right? And another thing that I think is going to be quite different compared to the primary resources is that also the technologies that we develop, we will also need specific qualities of the resources. So it's something that we never really thought about, but that now we can actually extend that. It gives us a lot more flexibility and degrees of freedom when we talk about multiple qualities of resources. And that's another concept that actually is called quality by design. It's actually something that comes from the pharma sector, where basically you have to build in the quality into a drug product. So you can actually do the same here to build in the quality in a secondary resource that you want to use. And then maybe another thing that I think might also be something that will come is that we also will need smaller scale technologies, because now we have the tendency of always going to very large scales. But I think the landscape will probably change, and likely we will use smaller scale technologies. In a sense, that's also good news, because in terms of design, I think smaller scale technologies are probably easier to accommodate. And then mobile technologies might be something else that we can consider. I think in fixed technologies, but you could also make them mobile and have them as a kind of service that comes and goes on site. Another thing that we have to take into account is scale. Yeah. So again, the big picture versus details. So you can look at different scales. You can look at things at the process level, at the plant level, at an interplant level, but also think of the circular ecosystem, where basically between plants of different companies. So you have to rethink the whole thing. And so I mean, that requires you to just forget about how things are organized now and think of how things could be organized. So basically, tabula rasa, you start from a clean sheet and you start thinking of how you can establish that. The other thing I mentioned, we can do the exercise for different resources, but you can also connect these resources. Yeah, and maybe you can create win-win-wins when you're connecting the problems and solve multiple problems at the same time. But that also will require additional, for example, platforms to connect the right people, right? Because typically in the water field, you have specific people working on something. In the plastics field, there will be other people. If there's some win-win that needs to be created, you need to connect both of them. Something that that Jan also already touched on is Industry 4.0, and indeed in the current, so this is currently being deployed, but I think we should also take this into account and use this as a powerful ingredient. So in my opinion, circular systems will be much more challenging in terms of monitoring, automation, and control, and it will be very much needed. So now we, in a linear system, basically your mass balance always holds, but if you start closing loops, important that hold and that you never have shortages, otherwise your complete system just collapses. IoT, so sensors, for example, 5G will become very important, I think, in these. And then digital twins, be it mechanistic AI or hybrid models, will be used at different levels in the company, across companies. And that might be something completely new, again, something that we have not really thought about, but it's definitely also a new thing. And also creates opportunities or to provide services that go across companies. An example of that could be, this is something I took from a colleague in the Singapore office of a Cambridge lab, who's working with ontologies. So here you can actually see these different levels illustrated. So you can organize things at different levels and then start creating synergies between plants and between industries. So an ontology is actually something that allows you to make some kind of high level digital twin and allows all these processes to communicate with one another. Okay, and again, also here, this is something that is definitely not the core business of an industry, because an industry typically looks or reasons inside their facilities, but there will be a lot more need for collaboration between industries. And I think also there, things that are not a core business will be, or should be, in my opinion, outsourced. Well, they will try maybe to develop it in-house, but they will soon realize that this is not such a good idea, because you can train people, but then people leave, and then basically you lose a lot of knowledge. So I think service companies will really gain a lot of ground in that respect. Yeah, and then cross domain is another one. So this is again a picture that I took from the earlier source. But here you can see this demonstrated. So you can do stuff, for example, on a water network, on an energy network, on a material network. But then all these things are interconnected. So also there, what you see is that typically these domains are completely organized separately, and I would say hardly communicate. So I think we have a big job to do there. And in the end, if you want to solve the problem at the high level, you will have to take into account the interdependabilities of these of these different parts. Just an example, and I'm almost finishing now. An example of a recent startup that I noticed is called Shape in the Brussels area, and what they do is they make fairly simple. They make measurement devices to measure flow velocities, or actually water velocities at in buildings, mainly for leak detection. Okay, and then but you should imagine, if you put that everywhere, what doors this opens. So you can not only detect leaks, but you can go much further. You can monitor, you can deploy models and develop models, and this will just create a lot of new activities and new ideas. Okay, so this is just one idea, that specific idea, As I mentioned in the previous slides, there's so many opportunities. If you just go over them and think a little bit about them in certain domains, across domains at different scales. So the sky is not the limit, I would say. Maybe some things. How do you deal now with all this complexity as an entrepreneur? Well, the thing is, you have to be proactive and not reactive. And I think what I mentioned, the important is you should have a long-term vision. For example, in the companies I work in, we have weekly strategic meetings and be on top of things that we do. Performance SWOT analysis, not once, but repeatedly. I'm a big fan of LinkedIn. There's a lot of content there, but also books. And also read outside your area of expertise, because that's when you typically see patterns and see or start seeing connections. Be part of Capture or similar networking platforms, very important. An ecosystem where all these things come together and where you have a constant, what I call a liquid network, where ideas float around and eventually come to play. Conferences and webinars, I think that's another easy one. Industrial professors, so I think it's a win-win. I think we probably should promote more that professors are part-time also working in industry or in companies. I think it's a much better way to also prepare students for the real stuff. Okay, try to connect the dots. That's also good. I mean, reading a lot, etc. But you also need to build in reflection time. So block time in your agenda to think. These days, walking is a very nice way of doing that, having reflection time. You enjoy it. You're outside and you can think of what you do. In a company, innovate and monitor your return on innovation investment. That's another one. And think out of the box. And what is important to understand is not everyone is wired this way. I mean, but that is people's brains are wired in a specific way. You have people that think on the detail levels and execution levels, and you have people that think on more the higher level or the big picture thing. And it's good to put together a good mix of people that span this whole idea. And whenever you come up with an idea, so how can you then test the market? Well, you can use these tools like LinkedIn. You can post ideas, you can post blogs, and you can check how people react to it. You can even ask them to react to it. And I always compare if you put a blog post on LinkedIn and you have like 500 views, that might seem not a lot. But if you give a keynote presentation at a small conference, there's only 200 people in the room. Okay, so you can reach a huge audience, and of course, if your network increases, you will have a much broader outreach. In terms of marketing, a good strategy that actually comes from this book, Good to Great, a very good book. First, throw some bullets, see how people react, and if you feel that there's momentum, then throw a cannonball, which means you go in with a very large campaign or you just launch a new product. Another thing that is a bit of a pitfall, maybe. So many around you will also not immediately see the opportunities or be skeptical about it. And that's what I want to couple back to the blue ocean. So that's good in a sense that, if you would launch it, you will probably be the only one. You must understand that people are also in a Gaussian curve. You have the innovators that always want to jump on innovation or the early adopters, but you have a vast majority that is also or late majority that is waiting a long time before adopting innovations. One thing that I also want to add is the interdisciplinary thinking and training. I think this is something that is also a bit of a problem. So if you look at where we are going, again, I put the picture here with all these interactions. We are moving towards complex systems with many interactions, many feedback loops. I already mentioned that from a control perspective, that's a challenge. But it means also that your solutions need to be at the system level and not at the subsystem level. And that's where it's a bit problematic, because the structures and the training that we provide is typically more focused on one discipline. You can see that in governmental organizations and sectoral organizations. There's probably hardly one intersectoral organization, but I think we need to work on that. Same with education. We tend to create specialists often, and we kind of neglect the creation of generalists, people that develop this interdisciplinary thinking. And I think we really need to work on that. And I think we also have an opportunity with lifelong learning to actually create that. And then I come to my last slide, just comparing that a little bit. So a generalist or a specialist are typically the people we know. They have a deep knowledge on a certain topic. They are experts in their field. They're experts. They can solve your problems. But a generalist tends to think more out of the box, has a broader knowledge base, not always the detailed one. He can is willing also to come out of the comfort zone. And so basically, in my opinion, you need a good mix of these people to also make something successful. So if you think about an opportunity or starting a business, I think it's good to not only have specialists. That's a mistake you often see, a bunch of people specialized in a certain topic. Yeah, but then you soon realize that you basically miss this part of the piece. Okay, that was mainly it. So thank you for your attention, and happy to receive any questions.